Hi, folks. I'm really glad you tuned in, and I really want to teach you how to create a direct mail postcard that actually generates leads for your business. It's really important to me that you have success, and the reason why it's important to me is because I am a citizen of the United States of America, and I know that small businesses are the backbone of the American economy, and it's just important to me that you do well. So hopefully you'll learn a bunch today that you can implement right away in your direct mail, whether or not you're using Postcard Mania or another direct mail company. I don't care. I just want you to do well. So I'll tell you a little bit about me. That's me and my kids and my doggies. Actually, we lost Layla about 2 months ago. That's the old white boxer there, but look how great she looks. That was at Christmas time, and she was already 12 years old and still looking good. I am a mom first, a wife second, and an entrepreneur simultaneously. My boys grew up around me working 12 to 14 hours a day, 7 days a week, building Postcard Mania, and now they both work at Postcard Mania. So just a little bit about me. Back in the day, I started in a little cottage that is local here in Clearwater, and it was just me and a few people. And as Jessica said, we now have 200 plus employees, and that's our facility that you see in the picture on the right over there. So what you're doing as a marketer is very, very simple, and I like to simplify it for you because it's so confusing these days. Marketing in general, there's so many different things going on in terms of social media. Should I do pay-per-click marketing, advertising, yellow pages, billboards, all the different online things, mobile marketing, there's so many things. So what are you trying to do as a marketer? What is your job if you're just wearing the marketing hat and not just owner hat, right? You want to generate a lead. However you do that, whether it's with postcards or whatever you use, you want to generate a lead. But you have to, these days, capture the identity of that lead so that you can follow up with them and you can nurture them and eventually get them to buy from you, and that's what we're trying to do. So what we're going to talk about today specifically is lead generation using postcards. Now, let's just take a look really quick of what is a lead so that we're all on the same page, because people call leads different things. A lead, in my book, is anybody who sees your advertisement and has some slight interest in it. And we really don't know at that point, the person looking at your ad, if they're hot or cold or just neutral, but if there's that little spark of interest, then that person could be a lead. But the only way you can make them into a lead and contact them is if you have their contact information. And today, basically, customers or prospects are behaving so much differently than they did years and years ago. It used to be you could put an ad in the yellow pages or in the newspaper and they'd pick up the phone and call you, and then you could do your magic on them and make them buy your product. But today, when somebody's interested and they're a lead, they're going to go online and they are going to do all their due diligence about your company online, and they're basically going to decide if they like you by what they find out online. So what happens when someone gets your direct mail piece and they're interested at all today, they're going to go to your website. They are either going to look at your website and make a decision about you based on that website, like, oh, this is a good company, I like these people, or, oh, I'm getting more data about this product and I'm impressed. Or they could go there and say, oh, this, I feel less confident in this company now that I've seen their homepage. So depending on your website, there are prospects that are going to just leave without ever interacting with you. And there are some that will become leads, but that's only if you have fill-in forms located in specific places on your website. Now, this particular webinar is not about fixing your website. All channels, all marketing channels do lead to your website. And I am going to be doing another webinar on that particular subject of how to make your website an incredible lead capture machine for you. But today's webinar is about how to drive traffic to that website using direct mail. Basically, what I've noticed is that sometimes people will throw up a website and think, okay, I have a website, but they have no idea how to make that website turn into a lead generation machine. And I can definitely help you with that. But you have to drive traffic there. People don't just arrive at your website just because you have a website. So let's talk about some direct mail statistics so that you can feel comfortable in using direct mail. You know, of course, being a direct mail company owner, I hear all the time, what are you doing about it? It's going away, isn't it? Like, wow, what are you going to do with your business? Like, direct mail is dead. Direct mail is so not dead. Direct mail yields an average of 13 to 1 return on investment. These are averages, by the way, on these statistics. And personally, I know that I can never operate off of an average. If somebody called my company and asked one of my marketing consultants, what will my response rate be? I would never allow them to answer with, you will have a 13 to 1 return on investment, because it's just simply not true. It really depends on the industry that you're in, how much competition you have, how aggressively your competitors market. But I can tell you now that I've been doing this for 18 plus years that we have seen a lot of businesses grow very, very well using direct mail. Now, if you're looking at lead generation and you're comparing direct mail to PPC or email, let's talk about that for a moment. PPC stands for pay per click. I don't know if you noticed that on the slide on the bottom left here. It says PPC with a tiny little arrow. It stands for pay per click. And that's when you go on Google and you search for something and you click on one of the ads, that company is paying for that click. That's all that means. And email, we all know what that is, but email, as much as I love email, and you wouldn't know about, you wouldn't be reminded of this webinar without email, it's not a great lead generation tool. And I want to explain to you why. If I get an email from a business that never asked me if they were allowed to email me to advertise to me, I immediately have a little bit of a distrust. From a consumer viewpoint, not from me, my viewpoint as the CEO of Postcard Mania, but from my viewpoint as a consumer, I'm just like, where did you get my email address? I've never opted into anything to just let you have my email address. So what are we trying to do with our marketing? We're trying to get people to like us and trust us enough to pick up the phone and call us and interact with us, because now, as I said earlier, they can do all their due diligence online without ever talking to us, which is a problem because it makes it harder to get people on the phone so you can close them. So what you're trying to do is get people to like you more. With direct mail, I decide when I'm bringing the mail pieces into my home. I am deciding when I sort through them and when I look at them. Whereas with email, I'm sort of accosted by your email when I'm trying to work or whenever it arrives in my inbox, regardless of what I'm doing. So this is one of the reasons why direct mail is so effective, because when we see a direct mail piece, we are not instantly annoyed that it's communicating to us because we originated the moment that it would communicate with us. We said, now I'm ready to receive the communication on this direct mail piece. So there is a 900% increase of response rate using direct mail versus these other two forms of lead generation. And of course, 60% of consumers have visited a website because of a direct mail piece that they received, and 75% of consumers try a business for the first time because of direct mail advertising. So very interesting statistics. DMA stands for the Direct Marketing Association, and of course USPS stands for the US Postal Service. That's where we got those statistics from. So let's look at this next one. We asked, this is a survey that we do in-house. We asked 18,396 small business owners, which types of marketing are you currently doing? And it was interesting that 31.6% of them are doing direct mail, and only 26% are doing Google pay-per-click. I'm shocked that almost 16% are doing Yellow Page ads, because I haven't looked. I'm in my 50s. I haven't opened a Yellow Pages to find a business in 15 years, probably, maybe 20. And 6.2% are doing radio spots, and only 3.5% are doing TV. What was really interesting to me is that 43.5% did not answer this question on the survey, which means that they're not marketing at all. So I just found that very interesting. So I wanted to share it with you. Now, when you're embarking on direct mail, one of the most important things is your mailing list. And I am asked all the time when I'm interviewed by publications, what is the most important component of a direct mail campaign? And it's a very, very, very difficult thing to answer. But what I can say is that if you mail to a list of prospects that wouldn't have an interest in your business, they're not part of your target market, they'll never look at your direct mail piece. They won't read your headline. They won't see your offer because they're not even interested in your, you know, if you're selling, what can I say, reverse mortgages to young couples that just moved into a home, that's not your target audience. And since postage is the most expensive part of your campaign, you've just, you know, basically flushed that money down the toilet. So it's very important to understand who you want to target for your product or service. And a lot of times I've had people say to me, well, everybody, you know, like chiropractors, everybody, I can help everybody with my product or service. And like, great, we need to figure out a target audience, because when you're creating the design of your piece, you want it to be very specific. So we can help you figure out who is in your target audience. Now, what I also tell small business owners quite often is for them to get a visual, get in their mind's eye of all the people in the area you service. And this is just because, it's just a little exercise I do, because there really is no scarcity of people that need your product or service. So I kind of like you to get the idea of all the people, even the ones that are not in your target market, and then sort of in your mind's eye, get the idea of the people that are in your target market in the radius surrounding your business that you service. And think with what are their demographics. And we can, you know, are they men with incomes with 60,000 plus? Are they single? Are they married? Do they have children? Are their children present in the household or not? Are they stay-at-home moms? There's all kinds of things that we can do to isolate the exact types of homes that you want to target. Now, I want you to think about those people that need you right now, and I also want you to think about the people who will need you in the future, because that's a really nice thing about a postcard, is that when somebody receives a postcard that's in your target market, even if they don't need you that moment, if it communicates to them, they might put it on the fridge, you know, they might move it around, they might put it on a desk and then in a drawer. I mean, I've literally had people call Postcard Mania that have received our postcard years and years ago and are finally ready to get started. So what kinds of lists are there? There are consumer lists, and these are people who live in apartments or condos or homes who have purchased any kind of merchandise ever, which includes everything. So it's just anybody who lives in a home, not a house necessarily, anywhere. And we can target very, very specifically, as I said before. What is SIC? SIC list is if you're a business-to-business advertiser, if you sell software to businesses, if you sell phone systems, if, you know, anything that a business would sell to a business. And SIC stands for Standard Industry Classification. And basically every single type of business has a four-digit code, and it can even be dialed down even deeper into a six-digit code. There's also opt-in lists. An opt-in list is, as I said, I've never opted into an email list, like people who've willingly given their contact information to be able to be advertised to. So for your own email list, you definitely want people to opt in so that they are happy to receive your communication. And there's also lists called a subscriber list. So let's say you sell those things that if you're a hunter and you sit in a tree, I don't know what they're called exactly, but you sell a product where you can sit in a tree so you can hunt, and basically you want to hit hunters, you can buy maybe a subscriber list to like the top hunting magazine and mail to those people. So, because it's really hard to buy a consumer list and say, give me the hunters, that kind of thing. So you can also saturate an entire area and save on the postage. You know, you can get a resident occupant list and reach every single person. A lot of times dentists, chiropractors will hit certain zip codes, certain areas, because they do want to hit every single person that's there. Now, you know, we, of course, at Postcard Mania can help you with a list, but if you want to get it somewhere else, that's totally fine with me. I want you to be armed with these questions when you're purchasing a list, because there actually are a lot of shysters out there and people who sell bad data. And so you want to find out how often the list provider's database is updated, and the answer should be it's updated continuously. Every single day, we are constantly updating. People are moving all the time. You also want to ask, is deliverability guaranteed? Well, they should say, of course, we guarantee deliverability up to 90%. Anything, you know, if only 80% of your, you know, if 20% of your cards come back, they should be willing to reimburse you for at least 10% of those. You should be able to feel comfortable that 90% of your mail is being delivered. People move all the time. You can never get 100%. I would say that we have a 95% deliverability rating. Now, you also want to know if the company will refund postage on any bad addresses as well as the cost of each bad address. So, you know, and can you reuse the list? Here's the thing. Direct mail is not a one-shot thing. You can't just hit one list one time and expect to change your business or change anything, really. It's a thing that builds momentum. And if you think about it in terms of how many times you need to look at an ad before you go, you know, ding, I think I need that product, you've seen the ad over and over again. So can I reuse a list? You want to get your list for what's called unlimited usage. Now, when you're buying a list, you're not actually buying a list. You are renting a mailing list, and you're renting it to use for 1 year if you purchase the option of using it unlimited number of times. So I never recommend buying a one-time usage. It's always usually like a couple of pennies more per record to get unlimited usage, and it's well worth it. Now we're going to get into the design. The very, very first thing that I want to communicate about design is that you have to design the postcard with the recipient of the postcard in mind. So what is this slide showing you? If you are selling wrinkle cream or, you know, lotion, facial lotion or whatever, you want to make sure that the way the design is done is going to communicate to women who might be having some crow's feet show up or some, you know, new wrinkles happening. And you don't want to have it, you know, be with a black background and, you know, and, oh, we're having a Halloween special on our face cream and we're going to use all these ghouls to advertise it because it's Halloween. You want to think of what is going to communicate to the person who is receiving the card so that it tells them that it solves a problem for them. You know, there's just so many examples. Maybe even the wrinkle cream is not the best one. I can tell you that when I was in my 30s, even my early 40s, I would receive advertisements all the time from financial planners. And I didn't understand what was written on the postcards. I didn't understand what was written in the letters. They were throwing out terminology from the financial planning world that I had no definition for. So I never looked. They weren't just solving a problem for me. They didn't say, hey, you're 42 years old and you should have reserves and you should be setting up income for your future. They would just say, we can get, you know, come to us for your IRA. I didn't know what they were talking about. So that's what I'm talking about when I say design the ad with the recipient in mind. So let's talk about something else regarding design, and it's a very interesting thing. It's called eye trail, and I'll read you this quote, but then I will show you an example of what I mean. In composition, you're working not only with the mood of the piece, but with the eye trail. The eye trail is vital in the layout of a design. The eye must go somewhere. Start at the top and follow down. Where it starts and where it goes is called the eye trail. And right here, you get into the basic formula of attract, interest, and message. The first thing you're trying to do with your postcard is attract with the colors and the headline, and then you have to grab their interest with some of the copy, and then you can get your message across. So the eye trail should lead one, pull one involuntarily through attract, interest, message. So let's take a look at an example. So this is a really good example showing that he's looking at the headline, the picture, the offer, right there. It sort of moves in the proper sequence. And let's look at one where, because I'm sure you've seen ads like this. I know I have. where there's a million starbursts with different offers and coupons, and there's really no, there's no iTrail. So really, you're filling up the space with as much communication as you possibly can, and really you're communicating nothing because the iTrail is just not good. And I'll show you, I'll definitely want to show you some examples of good and bad iTrail. So let's take a look at that. So this is good because the first thing I see is that this is about insurance, and I see that there's something for free. And I see that I'm going to get a gift card, and it's just about insurance. So I need insurance right now, so I'm interested enough in this card because I got the message to turn the card over. Now let's look at a bad one. And you just have to look at this from your viewpoint if you receive this in your mail. It's just there's too much going on, and I'm not sure. My eyes are darting back and forth from the light-colored side to the dark-colored side. I fixate on the picture, and then I finally see, renters, are you covered? But you know what? If I got this card in my mailbox, honestly, I wouldn't take the time to figure that out. I wouldn't even see the headline. I would just say, I don't know what this is. It's garbage. Now, here's another bad one. And let me, this is a little trick for you when you're approving any kind of a design. You see how these gentlemen on the left are looking down at their iPad. If, look at the next one. If they were looking at their iPad and then the, I wonder if you can see my mouse, they're looking at this iPad, but since they're looking in this direction, you're willing to look in the direction they are looking in, and you're willing to see, you know, this is a variable data card, meaning that we can change out the name on every postcard. So it could say, Joe, you're eligible for a complimentary financial review. And this could be Joe getting that review. So I'll go back to the last one. And do you notice how you kind of want to look over here a little bit? You want to look off to the left because that's the direction they're looking in. So you always want to make any photos of people, you want it facing the communication that you want read. So let's go through the 10 elements of an effective postcard design, and I'll just go through all of them with you. The very first thing is you need a clear and bold headline, something that grabs your attention that you look at first. It only takes one break-in to lose everything you love. So this is a good headline. It's clear, it's bold, it's easy to read. I think with iTrail, I read one break-in. I don't even know what they're talking about, but then I want to see the rest of it because I see the scary guy and I see the one break-in. Now, here's an example of a card. And this is a card we actually printed many, many, many years ago. It's not one that we designed. It used to be that half of our customers would send in their already designed postcards, but now I would say we probably design 80% of them. But there's no headline here. It's just the name of their company. And I'm not, my eyes are darting again all over the card because if you look at the coupons, they all have equal weight. So I'm not sure what to look at first. And there's no clear, bold headline of what does this company do for me. Here's an example of a clear, bold headline that's much better, especially when you take certain words that are more important in the headline and pull them out by making them bolder and bigger. Confidence begins, especially on a long headline like this, you have to do that. Confidence begins with a straight and healthy smile. And then it says orthodontics for all ages, and look at that adorable boy. My eye trail is going here and here. I see that there's a free consultation. I love that the doctor's picture is on the card. I only wish that my team would have flipped this photo in Photoshop so that his shoulders were facing this way, so that I'd be looking at the name of his company instead of over here, hospitality orthodontics. So that's something that you should look for. Always make sure that the photo is flipped if it's not taken that way to be facing the communication. Here's another good example of a graphic that is supporting the headline. Save thousands during our end of summer RV sales event, and what do you see? It's an RV. Very simple. You really never want to try to be so clever with your graphics and your headline that the person has to figure out what you sell. They won't take the time to do that. So if you can't really, I mean, if you can make your card humorous but also instantly understandable what it is that you're selling. That would be the ideal design. You want to make sure that the graphic supports the headline and that instantly the person knows what you do, either what problem you solve for them or what it is that you're selling. So let's give an example of where this really didn't work out. Now, we did do that. This client really, really wanted a dog. And my team kept saying, "Doctor, this is not going to work for you, a dog." I instantly, when I see Vein Doctor and the dog, I think, wow, I never knew that dogs had problems with veins. Don't you get that thought? So we will do what our customers ask us to do. So we designed it with the dog. And then we designed one that we thought would work better. And, you know, frankly, I don't even remember which one we wound up printing for the customer. We'll always give our expert advice. And we have at Postcard Mania thousands upon thousands of campaigns that we've cataloged across so many industries that we can probably find something that worked well in your industry. And that way you don't have to reinvent the wheel. You can just say, let me look at a bunch of cards that got great results in this particular industry. And then you can sort of glean some good ideas from those, and usually we'll have the numbers, you know, to not just saying, oh, this one worked. We'll show you how many patients they got or how much new business they brought in. And here's one. The third point is color that pops. This particular dentist wound up saying, use the colors that Postcard Mania used, because I always notice your postcard when it comes in the mail. So these are Postcard Mania colors. It's honestly, we have found that for dental, that blues and greens and, you know, toothpaste colors actually work really well for results. But colors that pop, and the reason why is because you're getting a lot of things in your mailbox, and if the design is aesthetic and the colors really pop, at least you'll take a look at it real quick. For sure, instead of something really dull like this. This has a lot of beige, and the headline and the image don't really go together, because it's the first thing I see is beautiful nails. Maybe if it said soothing facials and beautiful nails was smaller, this would be a good image, but it's not. And it's just a lot of copy for the front of a postcard, and the color's just not like really popping off in comparison to this one. You know, it's just red and black. We're not looking at using a ton of bright colors necessarily, but it has to have really good contrast so that you are forced to read the card. The fourth thing is that you have to have on the back of your postcard a sub-headline that leads into text. I've seen a lot of cards with a lot of text on the back, and honestly, the less text, the better. I really prefer just a really good subhead that continues the communication that the front of the card started, and then going into just the next part of what should be on the card. But let's talk about the subhead a little bit more, because I want to show you a bad example. This is a card, again, that we were given the design on many, 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 many years ago. And I'm going to give you a couple of little things if you listen closely right now. This card, there's a couple of problems with it. Aside from that, there's no subhead, so you're not compelled to read. And this graphic image here is just their logo. And so what I see here is all capital letters. And I want to tell you, on anything we're reading, it's difficult to read if it's in all caps. It's difficult to read paragraphs in all caps. It's easy to read headlines in all caps. Like up here at the top of the screen, it says direct mail design, easy to read. But when you start reading a paragraph, you really want upper and lower case. And on a computer screen, it's okay to have Helvetica or Arial, these fonts that are smooth without the little serifs. I don't know if you know what a serif is, but if you've ever seen Times New Roman, the reason why Times New Roman, the font, is used, it has those little curlicues on the end. Those are called serifs. And that actually helps your eyeballs go from letter to letter and word to word quickly, which is why newspapers use Times New Roman, because you're looking at paper, and you, to make it easier to read, that's the font that they use. So if you're doing a postcard and you're going to have any paragraphs of data, you want to use a font that has a serif. and you definitely want to use upper and lower case. So here's a good example of a subhead that's leading into text. Leave the worry of debt collection to us, and that's sort of, it's large, and then you have, then you're fine on going down to this smaller one. And you see here, you see these are the little serifs, these little curly Q's on the end of the bottom of the P, and here it helps your eyeballs kind of read. And you know, yes, I've already said I'm just about 52 years old, but I would say anybody over 40 starts to need to wear readers or something, and you want to make the card comfortable for anybody to read. A lot of times your designers are very young and they'll make the fonts very small, and you know, they're not thinking of the audience, so always keep your audience in mind. Benefits, benefits, benefits. This is such an important one. A lot of times we want to brag on our postcard about how great we are and how much everybody loves us. But really, if I don't know your business at all, the only thing I'm interested in as a consumer is what's in it for me. So the benefits are important to just bullet point out. The less paragraph copy you can have and the more bullet points, the better. And if you can make those bullet points benefits rather than features, then, I have a really good example that I can show you on that, just so you can see what a benefit is versus a feature. So first I'll show you this next card, which just is terrible. These are all features. These are not benefits. So turf fertilization is a feature. And what does that mean? It means, I don't know, I don't even know. What is triple core aerification? I have no idea. Overseeding. So I don't know, I don't see what are the benefits for me. You know, I could see like bed weed control. I could figure out that you're going to control my weeds and that's the benefit. But you really need to turn those features into a benefit. And it's not even easy for professional copywriters to do this. It's not an easy thing to do. You might want to get your team together, list out all the features of your product and service, and then have them each come up with what is the benefit of that product or service. It's a great exercise, and it'll help with your promotion. So here's kind of a good example of some benefits. This is a training. This is a martial arts training school, and this is the back of the card. But you know, support our heroes by training with us. And then it's build greater confidence, enjoy more energy, and better sleep. You know, these are the benefits to doing this training. Increase strength and learn self-defense. Decrease daily stress. I love these benefits. So, you know, like I said, you can sit down and kind of do a little exercise for your industry, listing out what the feature is and then what that benefit would be. And you'll see that it's not that easy to do. Sometimes features and benefits are one and the same. Like if it says that you're a family-owned and operated business, that's a feature. That's about you. But that's a benefit, too. It communicates a benefit because we get the idea that a family-owned and operated business has a higher care factor than a business where it's just, you know, a corporate business. It's not why I told you that my kids work here, but, you know, maybe you think, oh, that's nice, her kids work there. Serving the local area since, and like if you put in a date like, you know, 2001 or 1989 or any kind of, you know, more than 5 years ago, then people think, oh, they're credible, they know what they're doing, they've been around, they've been through hard times, they're still in business, they must be good. That's when a feature is also a benefit. And then here's a really great example, and I really enjoyed seeing this design the first time I saw it, because here we're putting the feature, digital x-rays, but we're also giving the benefit right after it. Accurate results with less radiation. Cosmetic dentistry, look and feel your best. Flexible hours, appointments that fit your busy schedule. So if you can write, if you can be succinct and be, you know, not too wordy, and you can put your feature and then say what the benefit of that feature is, all the better. Now, the next thing is number six. It's really, really, really important, is the offer. Let's talk about this for a minute. People today feel very entitled to very excellent free things. Let me give you an example. Google is free. I personally can't live without Google. It is the most amazing thing ever, and I use it every single solitary day. It's absolutely free. I don't pay a dime to use it. When I go to a cafe, if they don't have free Wi-Fi, I am really annoyed, and I think that they should just provide me with free Wi-Fi, don't you? And Facebook. Facebook is 100% free, and all we do is complain about how many ads there are and how when they change it, and we're just like, why do they keep doing this on Facebook? It's free. You get to connect up with people you haven't seen in 25 years for free, and you're complaining. So we as a society have grown accustomed to getting really, really great stuff for free. So your offer, you kind of have to think with that, like, what can I give away that is of a very high perceived value by the recipient, but is low cost or no cost to me? And that's another thing you can sit down with your team. If you can come up with an awesome offer, it's funny, we were at a staff meeting a couple of weeks ago, and my results manager had sent us a great testimonial from a client, a case study where a roofing company gave $1,000 off a brand new roof, and they had huge response to their campaign, huge return on investment. They made tons and tons of money. I mean, it was like the return on investment was, you know, like 100x or some ridiculous amount. And so we now have that cataloged so we can share it with other roofing companies. And another roofer did an ad, did a postcard, and I happened to see the design. And I said, wait, we just heard that they should be offering $1,000 off, and we added it to their postcard. So we have data in different industries, and we can kind of help you with that. But we expect something free, and it is important that you come up with a really, really, really great offer. Now, I'm just showing you a card that has absolutely no offer. If there's no offer at all, then I have no reason to act right this minute, and I probably never will. But if there's an offer with an expiration date, then the person's more likely to respond to your direct mail piece. So even if the offer, I personally think 10% as an offer is not a great offer. Percentages aren't that awesome. People prefer dollar amounts off than percentages off. And 10 is even like not a lot. It's not enough, you know, but it's still, it looks good because your eye goes right to it. Here's another one. You want to make sure that it's something people want. And it's funny, people want free stuff because we're used to getting free stuff. So you see how there's one free treatment, that's a good offer. 5% off treatment is not a really good offer. But here's something really interesting. When I got the PowerPoint from my team for today's webinar, I said, wow, this red arrow is fantastic, and it illustrates something else that I want to tell you about that's probably not even part of the 10 points, and that is that you should always make your call to action, this area right here, call us today to schedule a service, that's your call to action. You should always try to make it a completely different color that's nowhere else on the card, because the eye will just get dragged there involuntarily. And that's what happens with this big red arrow, because there's no red on this card. So I kind of dug that my team used a red arrow so I could illustrate that for you. So let's talk about what are some good offers. BOGO. You know what a BOGO is? It's buy one, get one free. This is the ultimate offer, and this is just based on statistics that came from successful direct marketing methods by Bob Stone. And so on a $100 item, buy one, get one free versus $50 or off versus 50% off, the buy one, get one free gets a 40% better response than either of the others. So if you can do a BOGO, fantastic. But what if you can't? So as I was saying, 42% of consumers found that money off was preferable to percentage off and free shipping. Interesting, because now we're starting to want free shipping for everything, and if we have to pay shipping, we're just annoyed. So I think free shipping is an incredible offer these days. $50 off generated 170% more revenue and a 72% better conversion rate than 15% off in another test when it was the same amount of money. The $50 off was 15% off, but the $50 off did much, much better. So these are just some offers that have came off of postcards And, you know, you, if you can make them bright and pretty and eye-catching so somebody sees them right away, then that's going to be, you know, much better. I love this. I love that the girl is looking right at you from the offer. Really good. Another beautiful-looking offer. I'm just going to kind of cycle through these. We can do scratch-off also on our postcard. So if you like the idea of scratch-off to see your discount, that kind of gets the person interacting with your direct mail piece, so they're more likely to read it if there's a scratch-off. It's just a little bit of an add-on cost. It's not really not that much. 7, 8, 9 seems obvious. Seems like I shouldn't have to have a slide telling you that you better have your company name and logo on the card. But you'd be surprised at how many designs have been submitted for printing that didn't. Also a return address. One thing you should understand, and this is just a nuance, remember in the beginning of the PowerPoint I was telling you that what you're trying to do is get the recipients to like you. You want them to trust you and like you, so eventually they become a hotter and hotter lead and they want to buy from you. And there's these little tiny nuances that help a person like you more or unfortunately like you less. Like if you have paragraph text and you're using a serif font and it's easy for the person to read, well, they like you a little more because of that. And if you have a street address as opposed to a P.O. box, they will like you more. Now, if you're working out of your home and you don't want to put your home address on your cards, go to a UPS store instead of the U.S. Postal Service and use a UPS store because they'll you can say their address and suite number for your box number, and then people think it's an office building. But that little tiny thing just makes you seem credible and not just a tiny homegrown business. And even if you're doing a great business, the perception is if you're working out of your house and you use a P.O. box. And if you're working out of your house, then your business is, you know, little. So anyway, that's just a tiny little thing. And then contact information. How do I find you? Where is your web address? Where is your phone number? Don't make me look for it. Just have it really super obvious. See, this is a card that somebody actually once submitted. No logo, no return address, no contact information. It just said, join a proven team. Anyway, of course, we didn't mail it. We told them, come on, guys, add it. And here, this is not even a good example at all, but because this back of this card is terrible. However, it does have an address, a company name and logo, and contact information. Now, the 10th thing, and I started to talk about this a little bit already, is your call to action. So, again, this is a very colorful card, and like, how do you take a colorful card and, you know, make your call to action super obvious? Black banner with a white reverse for the phone number and the website so that your eye is kind of dragged to the call to action. Here's one where I'm not even sure. I see the contact information, but I don't see a specific call to action. And you know, it's funny. We kind of want to be told what to do, like call today to make an appointment or go to this website and register or whatever it is that you want to have happen. You want to make sure that you communicate it as a call to action. I'll go back to this one. Give us a call or visit online. It's not just a phone number and a website. It's telling the recipient to give us a call or visit online. So just make sure that there is a noticeable call to action that your eye is dragged to when you approve your direct mail piece, whether or not we're doing it for you or you have a designer or you are a designer. So here you see the call to action is in a completely different color, this pink with yellow, and that way you're just not going to not look at it. You feel like you have to look at it. And you know, we put arrows on the PowerPoint, this big purple arrow, to show you where the call to action is. And I honestly, as you know, I started my business, I was actually a graphic designer. So that helps me a lot with this kind of thing, thinking with this kind of thing. And I actually prefer my graphic designers to actually use an arrow to point at the call to action as part of the design. Because, yes, you want it to be aesthetic, and aesthetics are very important. But the bottom line is you want somebody to call you and do business with you. And these things that I'm telling you today are very specific things that increase the results of your campaign. So let's just do a little quick review. We want a clear, bold headline, something that instantly tells you what the product or service is or what problem it solves for the recipient. You want a graphic that supports the message. You want color that pops. You want a sub-headline on the back. It's sub because it's not the main headline. That's the one on the front. A sub-headline that leads into text. Benefits, benefits, benefits. And if you can make what the feature is and what the benefit of that feature is, I like that. I really do. You want to have an offer that is compelling, something that is going to make the person, it's too good to refuse, it's too good to pass up. See how you can come up. That's another, you know, team building activity, honestly. Your team will honestly love helping you figure this stuff out. It doesn't mean you have to take their ideas and use them, but if everybody works together to come up with something that is super high value but low cost to you, you can get very, very creative there. On the offer, make sure you have your company name and logo on the card. Make sure that there's a return address and really good, clear contact information. And if you can make your call to action a completely and utterly different color than the rest of the card, you'll have more people looking at it for sure. So I'm not trying to make you into a graphic designer. What I want you to do is I want you to be able to approve any graphic design piece. I mean, how many of you actually have spent money on graphic design or marketing or a postcard and you felt like it didn't work or you didn't, you know, but you also didn't feel like you really understood what to do and how to make it work for you? And my job is to empower you as a client, whether you're my client or anybody else's client, so that you can make the right decisions and that you feel like you know whether or not the piece you're looking at is going to get you results or not. So make sure that you get these questions answered. Is the message I want to convey immediately obvious to the reader, the recipient? Will this message resonate with my particular target market? Am I highlighting the benefits or features or both? Am I making my prospects an offer they can't refuse? Do I have an easy, direct call to action with clear contact information? And does the eye trail of the card lead me to the offer and the call to action? This is what you have to ask yourself whenever you look at any kind of graphic design that a graphic designer gives to you. And that takes us to almost to the end of our webinar. I want to tell you about our next live event. I do a 2-day Postcard Mania for my customers. It is September 28th to the 30th. It's actually 2 days. I think September 28th there's a cocktail party in the evening and then it's all day on the 29th and 30th. It's a growth summit. You'll have 2 full days of information like I gave you today, but there will be a lot of practical assignments. You'll actually work on your marketing so that when you go home from the event, you'll feel very, very empowered. You'll know exactly what you're going to do, and you'll have a lot of things done already. So you know when sometimes you go to these events and like you hear some good information, but you're just so overloaded with the influx of information that it's too much and you wind up doing nothing. So what we've decided to do at our events is put you to work. So you're not just going to sit there and, you know, handle your emails on your phone while I speak. You're going to actually, we'll do a section like I just did, and then you wind up designing a card. You'll wind up figuring out what the features and the benefits are. You'll, you know, there's so much more to it. So if you want to get a little bit of more information about the event, you can go to postcardmania.com/growth summit and get a little bit more information. Now we also, one thing that I didn't talk about today that I should have talked about with you is consistency. I talked about it in my last webinar, but I should have talked a little bit about it. I did actually talk a tiny bit about it, that one, you know, that you should get your mailing list for multiple uses because one mailing one time isn't going to do anything. Consistency is so important, and I really understand that that's the way that companies grow. They grow from consistent marketing. It's like you don't throw out a campaign, you know, get in a bunch of business, and now you've stopped marketing. So when you're done delivering that business, you find yourself in the same boat you were in before, where you don't have enough leads. I mail for Postcard Mania, just for my own marketing, I mail 180,000 direct mail pieces every single solitary week. Now, I didn't do that in the beginning. Like Jessica said, I started with 1,000, then I upped it to 2,500 a week, and then 5,000 a week. And right now, if I closed my doors and shut this place down, we'd be getting business in for months and months to come because of the momentum that I've created over 18 years of constantly increasing my promotion, and I've grown the business. And sure, you have to juggle it and make sure it's profitable, but you have to keep your eye on like kind of the big picture. So what we want to do in order to sort of motivate you is, if you're already a customer with me and you have a campaign that's in progress, if you upgrade your campaign to be a six-month campaign, because that's really what it's going to take for you to really see how this consistency pays off in the long run, we're going to give you up to 25% off depending on what products and services you group together. And you'd have to call in. Call the number below, 1-855-514-2389 now to discuss your campaign, and we can upgrade you and take 25% off the upgrade. If you're not currently my customer, we will also give you up to a 25% off discount if you commit to a six-month campaign. Definitely mention that you just watched this webinar, and make sure you dial this number, 855-514-2389 now, in order to discuss your campaign. And there is something else I have for you. If you would like a copy of this PowerPoint, I can make it a PDF and I can send it to you, but you've got to email me, and this is not here anywhere, so you just have to write this down as I'm speaking. It's joy.gendusa, G-E-N-D-U-S-A, @postcardmania.com. And if you send me an email and say I'd like to have a copy of the presentation, I will make sure that you get it as a PDF. I believe that there might be some questions. So I'm not sure if anybody has written in any questions, and I'm not sure if Jessica's going to hop on and tell me if there are.
I'm a hop-in, Joy. Yes, we do have questions. So we started getting them pretty early on, and Roya was wondering, how many times should you target direct mail to the same neighborhood for effective results?
I would say forever until your results start waning, and then I would change up the design and the offer and sort of get them excited again about you. But I mail to the same list forever, basically. If it's my target market, and I'm sure it's my target market, I stay in front of them forever. Eventually, they'll need me. I won't stop. that is the truth.
Okay, so then Andrew's wondering, how can he anticipate the percentage of replies from per 1,000 mailings if he's offering final expense life insurance to a 50-plus age group?
You really can't predict anything until you start testing different mail pieces to see how many responses you're going to get. And truthfully, Andrew, It's an integrated approach that you're going to need, especially for the market that you're in. You're going to want to generate leads and warm those leads up over time, because that's not a spontaneous purchase. So I would recommend that you not only do a direct mail campaign, but that you make sure that you have some kind of a giveaway just to talk to them, because I'm sure if you get them in front of you, you can sell them, but you have to have a really good offer so that they're willing to give you their contact information so you can nurture that lead. So we have done a lot of successful campaigns in your industry. If you want to call the phone number you see at the bottom of the screen there, we can help you. But you need, specifically in the financial services industry, these are not decisions that people make, and you have huge amounts of competition. These are not decisions people make from a postcard, so the postcard just is going to generate the lead. So how do we get that person to interact with you? And that's where we have a lot of different programs that we can talk to you about. All right, any others?
Yes, there are. And if anybody else has another question, you guys can ask it in the questions tab. And in the chat tab, I also added Joy's email address. Sorry about that, Joy. So you guys can email her for a PDF. So Miguel has a longer question, and there's a couple aspects to it. He's wondering, I'm working on my website now. He's a new business, and I know it's very important to have one. But on mail pieces, what is the data on websites, on website hits versus calls? In other words, do we expect more calls versus clicks to a website, or must we have a website first before sending mailers?
You have to have a website first. I did talk a little bit about this in the beginning, that today people are going to do their due diligence online. They're going to look for ratings and reviews about you online, and you're a new business and you don't have that. So if they find nothing and not even a website, they probably will go, what the heck is this, if they get a postcard, and they won't even feel like you're legitimate if you don't have a website. So you do have to have one. Now, I know it's expensive to start a new business and have to buy all the different things that you need, and we have a really awesome website program where we do WordPress websites, which are the really cool looking ones, and we also know how to design them so that they capture leads, and we have a great program. You can get a 5-page website that's only $4.95 plus $50 a month, and we'll host it and we'll make unlimited changes every month for you, as long as you have your site up, and that way it's really, really affordable for you to get a great website.
Okay, great. This is not a Joe just said that this was a great condensed graphic design class, awesome content. The basics apply to any design. Let's see, Sue.
That's so nice of him. Thank you, Joe. I appreciate that.
David Jones agrees this is a very valuable webinar. He wanted to say thank you. Okay, so
you're welcome. That's so nice.
Ooh, I'm not even gonna try with this name, but somebody wants to know. I really can't. Somebody would like to know, what is the frequency of mailing to the same neighborhood forever?
What is the frequency? Okay, the frequency would be, it depends on if you have a product or service that is something that takes a long time to decide about, like for instance, I showed you an RV, you don't need to mail an RV postcard every single week or every month to the same list. You could mail it quarterly to the same list. You can hit the person quarterly, because people don't make that decision that quickly. It's something they're going to ponder for a really long time. But if it's something that somebody's going to decide on, like a dentist, or a chiropractor, or some home improvement type thing where, you know, you're hitting a neighborhood where all the homes are old and you know that they're going to need remodeling, or if you're a lawn care company, I wish I knew what type of business you were in, person whose name Jessica can't pronounce, so that I could tell you specifically for you. But basically, it depends on your industry and how quickly a person will make a decision. Like for lawn care, you're going to make a decision pretty quick. If you get a door hanger on your door or a postcard in your mailbox and there's a great offer, then you're going to just call them up and say, you know, I'm sick of mowing my own lawn. I'm going to call this company. This offer is too good to pass up. But so you want to hit them sort of regularly, because those types of clients, someone who's going to do lawn care, they can be your customer for 10 years and you can make a ton of money off of them. So you might as well hit that neighborhood over and over again, so you're the only company they think of for that.
Oh, actually, this turns out it is Dr. Batia. So he's a dentist. Uh-huh. He or she is a dentist.
Ah, okay. Thank you. For dental, we recommend that you hit the same people monthly, that you hit them every single month. They're either ignoring going to the dentist and hitting them every month is going to remind them, like, okay, I really need to handle this, or they're not super happy with their dentist, and so you want to be, the minute they decide that they need to go to the dentist, that they're ready to try a dentist, you want to be the one that they see. We have incredible results for dentists. So we have so many successful actions and so many successful campaigns that your customer service rep here, or your marketing consultant here, can go over that very specifically with you. And they'll ask you like 100 questions, maybe not that many. They'll ask you a ton of questions to really isolate what's going to be best for your practice based on how many competitors you have in the area, etc. So I really, really recommend that you call the number 855-514 2389 to speak to someone to really get the answer for your specific practice.
Okay, we have a few more questions. Do you have time? Oh, wow, we have more questions than I thought we did, Joy.
I'm okay with questions if the people are still listening. I can't see how many people are still on the webinar. So
we've got 56, so I'm ready.
Okay, good. I'm happy.
All right, so Michelle's wondering, what is the best marketing for private schools?
Oh, my God, what a great question. Private schools are one of my favorite industries to use direct mail postcards for because, again, you are getting money tuition from your students every single month. So the return on investment, to, like what you're willing to spend to get one new student could be higher, but it doesn't really take that much. I have so many successful campaigns for private schools. Postcards work fantastic for private schools. A good offer is waiving the registration fee and giving one free class. What kind of school does she have? If you find that out, I might have data. But you know what? Mm-hmm. Call the number, 855-514-2389, because we can tell you, we can show you so many offers that different schools, private schools, have used specifically to get in more students. We have a lot of successful case studies to share with you.
Great. Okay, next question. John is wondering, how much is the upcoming seminar?
It is only $97 if you're my customer. If you are not my customer, it's $997. So you could buy something, like you could buy a postcard, printed postcard. What are they, like 5,000 postcards for $300-something? I don't even know the prices anymore, but you can kind of put that on account with us and not even use it until after you've learned everything at the seminar if you don't want to, and get it for $97. Or you can start working on your campaign right away and get it for $97.
All right. Joanne is wondering, what can final expense or life insurance offer as free?
Good question. I don't know. You see, this is the kind of thing you have to sit down with your team and figure out, or we may have offers on file here. I know that we worked on a campaign, a large campaign for that very industry, because we do something here. I don't usually tell people this, but we get a lot of customers that will spend $5,000 or more the very first time they order from us over the phone. And that's a really large first-time order with a company. So I want to be involved in all of those campaigns personally, even though I have 200 staff. So I did work on one of these with my team, with my marketing committee team. And I'm sure we have the results data, but you have to call in and ask to speak to one of my marketing consultants, and they can pull that data up for you. So it's 855-514-2389.
All righty. Mark Stevens wants to know, do I need a system like MailChimp for you to coordinate my direct mail and email marketing?
Yes, we would have to have one of those. We usually sign people up with eye contact. Is that what it's called, Jessica? I can't remember.
It is.
So if you have MailChimp, that's fine. We can do the whole nurturing program for you, where we write all the emails and we coordinate them and send them out for you, or you can send them out yourself. It's up to you, but yes, you do have to have one of those programs.
All right, so then Tina wants to know, she's got a little backstory here. She has a small home pet sitting service. She doesn't have a lot of money for marketing right now, but wants to continue to grow. If she starts small and continues sending a small mailing list, mm-hmm. let me just say this as she said it. If I start small, I just continue sending to a small mailing list, or do I continue to make the list bigger and bigger as I can afford it? And how often do I mail?
Okay, good question, Tina. You definitely want to grow your list as your company grows and you have more money to do that. If I was talking to you myself, I would want to find out how big do you want to grow and how many pets can you watch at one time. Funnily enough, I am a very big customer of a pet sitter because my husband and I travel quite a bit, and they have a doggy daycare, and our three dogs go every single day to doggy daycare for the last gazillion years. So I know that it can be a very – I watched that business go from nothing to a fantastic facility, so I know it can grow very easily if you're doing a good job, because people are so they care so much for their pet. So I would start with a small list, and we could definitely get you doggy in the household, and we can also find out if everybody in the home is a worker, because you don't want to mail to someone if there's a stay-at-home mom, because then she doesn't need pet sitting or doggy daycare. So I would definitely explore, if you're going to do a small list, really making sure that we isolate the types of homes that we're mailing to so that we get people who would need a pet sitter.
Okay, great advice. So I think this is the last question from Keith, and he's wondering, I'm an insurance broker specializing in health and ancillary products. I think I said ancillary correctly.
I think you did too, but I don't even know what that is.
I don't know either.
Can you type, I guess, products that are similar, health insurance and other things that go along with that, is what I'm guessing.
Must be. We
use Google answer.
Yeah. Okay. I want to develop.
She's a copywriter. Jessica's a copywriter.
I haven't run into that one quite yet. So okay, Keith wants to develop more of a presence in the small business market under 20 employees. How frequently should they be marketed to? Oh, it's accident cancer.
Often, because what?
Oh, accident and cancer, etc.
Oh, okay. So it's just basically all the other types of insurance that he can sell. Okay, so you are in a highly, highly competitive market, and I would say that you need to hit the businesses over and over again, because they're hit by so many people one time, because most people market incorrectly, especially in your industry. So if you hit the same business over and over again, like choose your list and mail to them every single solitary month, then you're going to be top of mind. And when they start to go, all right, I'm ready to offer this to my staff, I'm ready to do this, you'll be top of mind. I can tell you that most insurance brokers do it incorrectly. They don't do it consistently enough, and they don't hit the same list enough. I've been doing this for 19 years, and that's the secret to your success.
That's a great note to end on, Joy. That was our last question. Do you have any other thoughts you want to share?
No. I just want to make sure that they know that I'll give them this PDF if they email me at joy.genduza@postcardmania.com. I thank you so much for your time. I really, really love helping small business owners. You can also email me any questions you have, but I have 25 or 30 marketing consultants, very trained in all across every industry, and you can call 855-514-2389 and talk to somebody, and I get all your questions answered. Thank you so much for participating in our webinar today. It was my pleasure.
Thank you, Joy. Thanks, everybody. See you later.